across the world. Let's stand together as we sing about our great joy.
While by the sea we watched at night, glad tidings brought an angel bright. How great our joy, praise our joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. There shall be born, so he did say, in Bethlehem a child today. So praise our joy, praise our joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. There shall the child lie in a stall, this child who shall redeem us all. How praise our joy, praise our joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. This gift of God will cherish well, that ever joy our hearts shall fill. How great our joy, great our joy, 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 joy. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high. Praise we the Lord in heaven on high.
Well, amen, church. Things changed since last Sunday. If you weren't here Sunday night, last Sunday night, we watched all of this unfold before our very eyes while singing Christmas carols and great spiritual songs and watching our youth work. It was a nice change of roles. They did all the work and we watched. And for those of you that happen to enjoy cookies like I do, you did a great job in bringing cookies too. We sat around and ate cookies till I couldn't eat cookies. I walked away from the cookie table while there were still a lot of cookies on the table. So thank you. Those little silly things provide us fellowship opportunities, and I thank you for participating and being a part of it. Let's go to the Lord. Father, we love you this morning. How we thank you, Father, for all the good things in life that you so freely give us. And Father, for us as followers of Jesus, Lord, everything radiates out from that relationship, and all the good things that come to our life and into our life and through our lives, Lord, is because of your Son, because of our commitment to him and his amazing love for us, such as we are. His love, unconditional, always in our corner, Lord, always pulling for us. Father, we thank you for this Christian faith. We thank you for the men and women, boys and girls who proclaim it boldly, without a shame, Lord. They're devout followers, and they don't mind telling people. They're fully convinced. And Father, for others, we pray for them, Lord, as there may be those who are seeking your face, who are leaning in at Christmas time to be reminded what this Christmas is all about. Father, I thank you for everybody that's here. I know it was according to your plan that they be here this morning. And Father, we all gather together as the family of God. We bow before you in humility. We ask you, Lord, to speak to us, even truth from the Christmas story, Lord, that's good for us. It's good for this day. It's good for our hearts, and it's good forevermore. Lord, we thank you for everybody here. We pray a blessing on each and every one of them that came to your house on your day to worship. And we'll be careful to give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you're visiting with us, there are cards in the chair in front of you. Feel free to fill that out if you want to. Put it in the offering plate when it comes by. Otherwise, we just want to take a moment and just kind of welcome you, shake hands, welcome one another. All right?
angels call to shepherds, leave your flocks at rest. Journey forth to Bethlehem, find the lambkin blessed. Sing we Noel, King is Lord Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel. In the stall they found him, Joseph and Mary mine. Seated round the manger, watching the holy child. Sing we Noel, King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel. From the eastern country came the kings afar, bearing gifts to Bethlehem, guided by a star. Sing we Noel, our King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel. Gold and myrrh they took their gifts of greatest price. There was there a stable so like paradise. Sing we Noel, King is born Noel. Sing we now of Christmas, sing we now Noel. Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plain, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strain. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Excelsis Deo, Gloria.
I have seen the light shining in the darkness, bursting through the shadows, delivering the dawn. I have seen the light whose holy name is Jesus. His kingdom is forever. He reigns on heaven's throne. Yes, I have seen the light.
Glorious gift given to us 2 millennia ago. It's all we need, folks. For everything we've done wrong, for all of our sins, that one gift when he died on the cross took those away from us. Christ is enough. For me, he is enough for you.
Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing, no turning back, I've been set free. Joy of my salvation, and this hope will never fail. Heaven is our home. Through every storm, my soul will sing, Jesus is here. To God be the glory. The cross before me, the world. turning back, no turning back. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no.
Savior born in flesh on earth. To one man, he was his baby boy. This manger for your bed, you have a long road before you. Rest your little head. Can you feel the weight of your glory? Do you understand? Does the Father God your heart for God so you can see tonight? Go to sleep, my son. Go and change your dreams. This world can wait. For one moment, go and sleep in peace. I believe the glory of heaven is lying in my arms tonight. The Lord, I ask that He for just this moment. Simply be my child.
Nice to hear that from Joseph's side of things, isn't it? It's all about Mary, it seems, and it's nice to be reminded that Joseph had his role to play, and that may be very well much of what he said one of those nights as he struggled to understand all that God was doing. The passage that I have for us this morning that's before us doesn't look like a revolutionary document. Just 10 verses of a Jewish teenager's composition. I mean, when you think about revolutionary documents, you may think of things like Adolf Hitler's Mein Kampf, or Karl Marx's Das Kapital, or Mao Tse-Tung's writings. You know, you don't think about these words of Mary as being a revolutionary document. But somebody has said, if you understand the words of this poem, you understand it is the most revolutionary document ever written. It is a revolution in God's fulfillment of Scripture. It is a revolution in a personal spiritual experience. And it's a revolution in what God will ultimately do in history because of what happened in that manger. This song was sung when Mary visited her relative Elizabeth, who at the time was pregnant with John the Baptist, and she had received the word that she would be the mother of the Messiah. If you can understand the words of this passage, you can experience a spiritual revolution in your own life. You have the gospel, you have your New Testament, you have Luke there in your hand, or you're welcome to watch on the screen. We have the New King James Version that we'll put up as well. Let's look at what Mary composed in what might have been one of her finest hours. Luke records for us, and Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for he has regarded the lowly state of his maidservant. For behold, henceforth, all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has pulled down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and to his seed forever." And Mary remained with her about 3 months and returned to her house. Mary's song speaks of a revolution in the fulfillment of God's promises in the Bible. If we did not have the manger of Bethlehem, the Old Testament would be like a lock without a key, or like a violin without a bow. When Malachi wrote the last promise of the Old Testament, and he brought down the curtain on all of that time period that is represented in the Old Testament, 1,000 promises of God had yet to come to be fulfilled, had yet to be realized. The history of the Old Testament is peopled with prophets, with foreseers, with seers, with predictors, and their words hang heavily over history before the birth of the Messiah. It was like the credibility of God had been stretched like a giant rubber band, and it was about to break if there was not fulfillment. If God did not answer what he had prophesied, if God did not fulfill that which he claimed would come to pass, the credibility of God was on the line as the Old Testament came and as it closed. Mary sings about a God who always keeps his promises. It's important today because the God who did keep his promises will keep his promises. The poem is called the Magnificat because of that first word, that first verb that Mary used. It's important today because of it simply means in Mary's heart, I magnify the Lord. We'll get to that in a minute. But she's her state and purpose is I will lift up and I will magnify the God, basically, of the Old Testament. It's a composition largely of Old Testament quotations, a collage, if you will, of what comes out of the Old Testament. It's amazing that this teenage Hebrew girl, 14, 15 years old, had so memorized the Word of God that she could quote in these 10 verses from, first of all three sections of the Old Testament. I mean, she quoted from the law, she quoted from the prophets, and she quoted from the writings. And if you further break down those quotations, you discover that Mary quotes from Genesis, Exodus, Deuteronomy, 1 and 2 Samuel, Job, Psalm, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Habakkuk, Micah, Zephaniah. Need I say more? I wonder how many of us could quote from those books. At inspiration, at a moment, she composed these in her heart. The words are out of the Old Testament, but I tell you, my friend, that's the music of the New Testament. And that is the spirit of joy that would be characteristic of the New Testament. And it is interesting that when God chose this young woman to be the mother of the Messiah, one of the prerequisites for to be the mother of the Messiah is that she be steeped in the Word of God. That she be a learner, a student, a humble sponge, soaking up what God had said so many years before and prophesied and said would be the fulfillment of His Word. Just look at three of the Old Testament quotations that remind us God keeps His promise. God keeps His promise to the oppressed. God keeps His promise even when we don't understand what He's doing. And God keeps His promise even when we think He's forgotten all about it. In verse 48, Mary saying to God, because He has regarded the lowly estate of His maidservant. Now that's a quotation from 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 11. It comes out of the story of Hannah, of childless Hannah, if you recall. And she asked God to look down upon her, of course, which He did. Somebody has said, anybody could have said, that the Old Testament is absolutely full of groans and moans, sobs, disillusionment, and disappointments, depressions. And they're only partially answered in the Old Testament. They're partial in what information is given. The truth is, the Old Testament is a partial book. It's a fragmentary book. And when we read this song of Mary, we read that every groan, moan, sob, disillusionment, disappointment in all of history was focused on what would happen in that manger at Bethlehem. Mary could say, God, you have regarded the lowest estate of your maidservant. We can come to this Christmas knowing we serve a God who hears every cry of disappointment, every cry of disillusionment that we can bring to Him. Whatever your state, however unique your life, your situation, Every single one of us can bring it to the Lord Jesus. For in the Lord Jesus, He answers your disappointments, your heartaches, your losses, your sorrows, the shortcomings. In Christ, they're all answered, and times a thousand besides. Some people, this first Sunday in December, are coming to Christmas happy. They are coming under circumstances and a place in their life where they're filled with joy, they're anticipating, they're excited. It's a great time for them, and they are ready. But that's not everybody in the room. We also have people here today that, while they may not say it out loud, they are dejected. They are not happy. There are things that weigh them down. Some people feel like God's pulled the rug out from underneath them. Some people feel like nobody cares. We're friendly and we're nice, but that no one really cares. Mary saying that God keeps His promise to those who are disappointed and to those who are disillusioned. And Mary says God keeps His promises to those who don't understand what He's doing, to those who don't get God, who can't make sense of His actions. Mary quotes Habakkuk, who was a prophet who also had a like problem. Habakkuk said, I don't understand what God is doing, and the longer I wait on Him, the less I understand. Ever feel like that? The longer I wait, the more confusing it gets. The more I look at things, the more confused I get about how this big mess is going to somehow be worked out. Habakkuk said in chapter 3:18, yet I will rejoice in the Lord, I will joy in the God of my salvation. Despite the fact I don't understand, despite the fact that I don't get it, despite the fact that there's all this confusing stuff going on, and I don't see what God is doing, yet I will rejoice in the Lord, I will joy in the God of my salvation. Mary opens this song quoting Habakkuk, saying, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. Just like Habakkuk, Mary didn't know what was going on. This poor teenage girl, she was with child, she was without husband, she was the subject of gossip in Nazareth, and in a generation that stoned women in that condition, even though she didn't understand what God was doing, she said with Habakkuk, nevertheless, I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. I think we talked about this a little bit last week, church. If you were here, I think we're plowing the ground that says, no matter what I see, taste, smell, think, or hear, I believe in a God of supreme love. Love that would take His only Son and put Him on a cross just for me. Vile though I was, shed His blood in love for me. That kind of love is beyond question. That kind of love will eventually conquer all oppositions, complaints, disillusionments, and discouragements. Mary also quotes those who think God has forgotten them. It's a common sentiment among people. Somehow I've been passed over. Somehow God's been busy about doing other things, and I've just been kind of washed to the side. I'm just kind of over on the edge. Nothing's going on. Micah was God's prophet in the 8th century before Christ, who ended his prophecy in chapter 7, verse 20, with this word of promise. You will give truth to Jacob and mercy to Abraham, which you have sworn to our fathers from days of old. God is faithful to what He has said. And in the distant future, He will be faithful to what He has promised in days of old. Mary said, God, you made an oath long ago that you would remember us. And what happened to those words of Micah? Let's just play the devil's advocate. Would you let me do that? Micah's not just some character, minor prophet on the stage. Micah had an experience with God that few of us will ever have. The very city where Micah prophesied was in ruins, destroyed, razed to the ground. The temple was destroyed in which he had worshipped, and still God did not keep His promise to Micah. The Jews were carried off to Babylon. God did not did not keep his promise to Micah. 3 centuries, count them, 3 silent centuries went by, and God didn't keep his promise to Micah. And it was as if the very earth itself cried out to the heavens, where is the promise God made to Micah? Where is what Micah claimed to believe and hold on to? Where is it? How long do you have to wait before God shows up? 3 centuries, a destroyed nation, a destroyed temple, all of that's gone. Well, let me tell you, Mary was feeling some of that same darkness. Pregnant, lost her husband. It wasn't easy for her, this spiritual young lady who knew God and yet had been dealt with in this fashion that socially destroyed her life, put her as an outcast as far as she could be put in the little small town in which she had been born. You know, during World War II, it was before my time, just for so as you may be doubting, I do love that time period, but I wasn't there. During World War II, when London across the pond was being bombed by the German bombers, the people of London realized they had to take out every light that they had in their homes and streets and everywhere in order to blind, as it were, the German bombers who came at night so they couldn't find their targets. It was just a common sense defensive mechanism to shut down all light so that nothing could be seen at night. And those who'd lived in London all their life made the remark that as long as anybody could remember, you could never see the stars above London because of the lights. But when they turned out all the lights and they waited in fear as German bombers came to kill them, they looked up and for the first time they could see these brilliant lights, these amazing constellation that God had spread out above them. And those stars, doubtlessly, especially at Christmas time, must have reminded them of God's promise, that star of promise that appeared to the wise men. God keeps his promise. God will keep his promise. Look at how Mary ended this song. She ended it with a reference to Micah. In verse 54, she said, he has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. Some of you think God has forgotten your zip code or he's lost your address. God doesn't forget. He doesn't lose addresses. The Christ who promised, lo, I am with you always. The God who promised Abraham didn't forget. The God who promised Micah didn't forget. He remembered. The God who promised to Mary and kept his promise is the God who will keep his promise to you. Some historians some time ago wrote a book called If. It was a book that they explored what might have happened if history was different. For example, what would have been like if Lee had won at Gettysburg? What if Booth would have missed Lincoln with the shot he fired? What if the Muslim Moors had conquered Spain instead of the Christian Catholics? Ask yourself this question. What if God had not kept his promise at Bethlehem? The Old Testament would have ended with a question mark instead of an exclamation point. And we wouldn't be reading this song this morning for sure. You may say, so what? So God keeps his promises. Is that the point of all of this? God keeps his promises? Well, the only assurance we have that God will keep his promises, my friend, the ones that are yet to be fulfilled still, is the fact that he kept his promises to those of the Old Testament. We have a pattern. We have a history. This song is a revolution in the fulfillment of prophecy But not only that, it is a revolution in personal spiritual experience. This song can be a devotional book. You have the intestinal fortitude, the spiritual acumen, and the mental tenacity. You can take these 10 verses and milk them all month long. They will buoy your spirit and give you a revolution in your own heart listening to this teenage Jewish woman called upon by God to serve. This song is amazing. It's a perfect statement of personal spiritual devotion. It's personal, it's inward, it's subjective. These are Mary's words, which what God's done for her. It's intensely personal. It's her composition via the Holy Spirit. And it's also outward and it's objective. It speaks of what God Himself is like and what He will do in the future as it relates to Abraham and to his seed forever. Mary reacts to what God is doing in her life. I hope you did some of that in your Bible study this morning. I hope all of you were in a Bible study this morning to share with us what God is doing in your life, that it might encourage us, that it might be a strength to us, or that in the absence of what God's doing in your life, you might take heart in those of whom He is working and what God does, and rejoice with them in what God has done in their life. In verse 47, she's emotional, she's devotional, she's confessional. She says, "My soul magnifies the Lord." Or another way of saying that is, my soul makes God large. My soul enlarges God. Now, I know some of you are thinking, you can't make God bigger. And you are 100% correct. That's not what Mary is saying. She's extolling God. She is lifting Him up, and she is magnifying Him. You know, when I spend regular time in God's Word, I'm amazed at how big God is and how powerful He is. But when I depart from the Word, when I'm on my own for some period of time, it's just not quite as much on my mind. I don't see Him as great because my memory of what He's done, the promises He's made, the promises, they begin to fade in an amazingly short amount of time. I've often joked that God made me a preacher because He had to tie me to this book. I would drift away if I was just left to read it freely. I had to make my life's career out of this. It was God's way of shortening the leash on my life, to pull me close to the Bible and nail me there on a short chain where I couldn't wander far. It doesn't take me long. I can go on vacation. My family can testify. I can be a pagan quick apart from God's Word, worship, regular time with Him. I say, Jesus who? It's horrid how dark this heart is, how black it can go, how quick it can go from bad to worse. We steep ourselves in this Word because in this Word is life. In this Word are the answers to all of your questions and to all of your problems. Has God answered you? Miraculously and supernatural, has He given you all that you need for your path, for your way, not just to get through it, but to triumph over life? In every possible conceivable way has God provided for your victory. We enlarge God. We extol Him. When I fail to magnify God, it diminishes me. It shrivels my soul. Amen? Yeah, come to church and talk to the brothers and share your heart and visit with one another in your heart. Your spirit just grow. And you walk out of here ready to conquer hell. Six days later, you may come back in a little different posture, right? Get stomped on, spit on, cursed on, all that week. You're going to get beat out of you. You come back and you say, God, breathe life. And that's what the 23rd Psalm is all about. God restores my soul, David said. He gets me going again. He infuses me with His power and His presence. When I magnify God, it enlarges my life and I grow. By the exercise, I grow when I understand more about the greatness of His might, of His mercy, of His power. It ought to be all of our desire to make God great in this Christmas season. In verse 47, hear her emotionally say, "My spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior." She said, "God is great and I rejoice about it." That word rejoice means to leap as in a dance. Her soul magnified, her spirit rejoiced in God. With everything she had, I praise God. Somebody has said, and this is worth putting in your memory banks, that it's Mary who's the first one in the New Testament to make a public confession of faith. That is exactly what I just read to you and we read together. My spirit has rejoiced in who? In God, who? My Savior. She recognized God to be the Savior of her soul as that wonderful one was being formed underneath her heart. While that sacred seed was growing in her womb, she spoke of God, my Savior. Mary is not the queen of heaven. I repeat, Mary is not the queen of heaven. She is just like you, and she's just like me. The baby she carried would be her Savior. You know, if you look at the last days of Mary's life that we have recorded for us in God's Word, one of the last times we see her, she's at the foot of the cross, right there with other people who need Christ's cross in their life. The very last time we see Mary is in the upper room with his disciples praying and asking God for the Holy Spirit, the Comforter that was about to be poured out. The last picture, Mary, this one who brought him in, watched his 30 plus years of life, stood at the foot of his cross, and heard of his resurrection, she came here and invited him into her life. She makes the confession, "He is my God." Some of you need to do the same thing that Mary did this Christmas. You need to confess Jesus as both Lord and Savior of your life. You haven't really come to the manger until you can say with Mary, "He is my Savior." What a great Christmas gift for all of those apart from Christ to be found. Mary also reflects on what she's doing. She reflects on what God did in the past, what he's going to do in the future. In the past, God said, verse 48, he regarded the lowly estate of his maidservant. She remembered the announcement that was said to her that she would be the mother of the Messiah. Her statement is about her social, economic, and external condition. She was one of being oppressed. God looked upon one who was low, who was oppressed, who was crushed, who was obscure, a peasant girl from a town so remote that we can't even find it in the Old Testament. Nazareth doesn't even appear anywhere in the Old Testament. It's so remote and at the end of a road, the dead end spot of middle of nowhere. It's not mentioned for anyone, any purpose. And yet it was there that he found this humble one. It's there that God took the humble. You know, that's how God does it. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul says that God takes that which is nothing and uses that which is nothing to bring to nothing that which the world says is everything. And God has continued to do that. It's his M.O., his modus operandi. It's how he works. And who can guess it and who can trace it? There may be somebody here this morning who feels like that. You feel like you're a nobody, that everybody forgot you, nobody loves you. Listen, at Christmas time, God specialized in going to people who felt like they were nobodies and said, "By my grace, I'm going to make you somebody." And 2,000 years later, we look back on that teenage girl and we read her song. But then she looked forward. This is it's simply remarkable. Here's this little girl who's never been a day or 2 days away from her village. And she says, "From now on, all generations will call me blessed." Now, either Mary is an egomaniac, which I've not heard a lot of people say, or she's speaking the word of God. It's either the most egotistical statement ever made, or it was a sentence inspired by the Holy Spirit. Mary meant we would look back and congratulate her. We would say, you are fortunate. You are blessed because God looked at your low estate. You and I are part of the fulfillment of the prophecy of Mary. Mary also related to what God had done in her own life. She looks at the attributes of the Old Testament revelation of God, and then she relates those to herself. She says in verse 50, His mercy is upon those who fear Him. Verse 49, For He is mighty and has done great things for me, and holy is His name. She doesn't talk about God in the abstract. That's not the Christmas message. The Christmas message is that the Mighty One has done great things for me. That I can stand and say, God has done mighty things for me. The might of God is there in the Exodus. If we want to talk about the might of God in the Old Testament, this Jewish girl says the might of God in the Exodus had led a new Exodus through what He was doing in her body physically, through the growing of the Messiah beneath her heart. And He will bring about a brand new Exodus, greater than the Exodus of the Old Testament. The angel had promised her the power of God would overshadow her. And now Mary says His might has done great things for me. Christmas is not Christmas, folks, until God's might is active in me. Christmas is not Christmas until God's power is active in my life. And then she speaks of God's holiness. In the Old Testament, the holiness of God was a terrifying thing. The inaccessible holy God. I mean, the Holy of Holies, where only the high priest, only once a year, can even go in there. It's a fearful thing. Moses on Mount Sinai, God speaking to him, and nobody wants to have anything to do with that mountain because the holiness of God resting upon it. Now Mary says, God has done a holy thing in my life. The extraordinary holy life of God comes into the ordinary life of every willing person. It's quite remarkable when you think about it that you and I living here in America, that from something that happened 2,000 years ago, that there's a supernatural power that can enter us, that can come into our life and generate in us a life such as we couldn't have imagined. We couldn't have done it for ourselves. We couldn't have thought about it. We couldn't have conceived it. And that we could have power over our sinful beings. That we could be set free, chains could be broken, and we could be a new creature. It's mind-boggling. I see why people understand it to be science fiction. Where else is this proffered? Where else are people talking about this at Christmas? Let me say it another way. If your religion isn't personal, it's not anything. If your religion is not personal, it's not anything. You ain't got jack. You just got some belief system. You believe something. And who cares about what you believe? But now if you've got supernatural power dwelling in you, that's given you power over sin and forgiven your life, and you've been set free and made a new creature, and you're in the model, the image, the character of Jesus Christ, now that's something to talk about. And that's something to observe, to watch and see if it's the real deal. I was talking to a man at men's breakfast this yesterday morning. We missed some of you fellas, by the way. Love to have all you guys there, man. You're missing out, I'm telling you. We had a good time at breakfast, but one of the men was telling me how he's been praying that God will do a work in his heart. And part of that work is so that his family might respond to the Lord, might see what God's doing in his life. And that very thing happened this week. He did something out of character with who he had been as a father all of his life, such that when the kids saw what he had done, they said, "What did you do with our father? Dad, where did he go? What happened to him? Who is this nice, wonderful man?" Right? Every father here prays those very same things. and how glorious it is when God gives us a chance to exhibit the supernatural change that only Christ brings in our life. Mary looks beyond the manger. She looks to the ages. And she becomes a prophetess. And she says what God will do in all of history because of that Holy One that was growing beneath her heart. It's interesting that she speaks of the future as if it's the past. This is where Bible study can get tough. This is where the weenies fall by the wayside. And those who pursue God with all their heart dig up gold. Six verbs, six times she uses a past tense verb for what she is prophesying is going to come to pass. In verse 51, he has shown strength. He has scattered. He has brought down. He has exalted. He has filled. He has sent away. She was so certain of what God would do, she spoke of the future as if it was the past. And by the way, this is the only place in God's Word where this happens. It is rather common. We are able to speak with certainty of things in the future so much so we can talk about it as if they're done. We can talk about God lifting us all up from this place and taking us to be with Him where He is. The snatching up of our bodies and the changing of them. We can talk about it as if it's a done deal because it is so certainly what God has said, what He has promised, and in fact what He will do. She saw a paradox of what God would do with the proud and the powerful, the privileged, through the one that was growing inside of her. This verse 51, God has shown His strength not to the proud, but to the common shepherds. The proud are those who look down on God with contempt. What does He do? He scatters them. He brought the word of the Messiah to the humble-hearted. From as far as you can go back and look, God always scatters the proud. God will not share His glory with anyone, and especially those who are proud. In verse 52, Mary says, God put down the mighty from their thrones and has exalted the lowly. How in the world could a teenage girl say that He's already toppled the thrones of the powerful and that He's going to lift up the humble? Well, if you look at the principal characters that take place in the Christmas story, the birth of Christ, and in the letter that she wrote of what Mary said, you can track it. Augustus was the Caesar when Jesus was born, and in 14 AD, he died, probably poisoned by his wife, Livia. Herod the Great, who slaughtered the innocents, all of those babies in Bethlehem, trying to kill the Messiah, died one of the most tragic, awful deaths that can be died by a human person. You can read about it. Josephus tells us about it. Eusebius, outside of the Bible, tells the Bible just says it succinctly, and the worms ate him up. Boom. But Eusebius and Josephus, they tell, I mean, his flesh began to rot. He was worm-infested. He died screaming in pain. I mean, God will topple the powerful from their thrones. Make no mistake about it. Pontius Pilate, who washed his hands in the trial of Jesus in AD 36, was deposed, and he was sent away to Europe, ostensibly Switzerland and the Lake Lucerne area. And there he is said to have jumped from one of those massive peaks into Lake Lucerne, committing suicide and taking his own life. God will, no doubt, topple the proud from their thrones. But church, if you can humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, if you can come to your senses just for a minute, you can just have a moment of sanity when realizing you're made out of the dust of the earth, created by a unique creator who wants you uniquely made in His image and so formed you and shaped you and has a plan for your life that equates to the uniqueness of the creation that you are, the crown of creation. We stand as the greatest thing God made and created in this universe. It makes all the sense in the world that He wants to be with us in it, that He wants to fill us and live a life that He has determined we would live. How about you this Christmas season? Where are you in that spectrum of humble and proud? You can do it the hard way, or you can do it the easy way. Mary calls to us. She sings to us in poetic fashion this Christmas season. Let's pray. Father, I listen to Mary's words and I marvel too at her ability. Clearly, your Holy Spirit inspired this woman to write what she wrote so early in her life, such a young age. She's going to age a lot in the next 30 years as she watched Jesus live and give his life a ransom for many, and to seek to understand that herself so that she can be saved by the very son she gave birth to. And Father, we too at this Christmas time have opportunity to receive Jesus. The same way the world was given the gift of Jesus Christ, we may accept him on a personal basis. We may personally invite him into our heart and into our life. And God, I pray that we start this season, our hearts would be turned to you. We could see a revolution in our spiritual lives, Lord. So many of us are living subpar in being filled with your Holy Spirit and being in the center of your will. God, this whole room could make the decision. We want to move closer. We want to enlarge. We want to extol God. We want to lift up Jesus Christ. We want his name to be on our lips all the time and in our thoughts continually. And on the praise of our tongue, it all turns in life. Father, do your great work of reviving us, giving new birth to those who ask and humble faith for it. God, do your work that you do so famously with your people. We humbly bow, we humbly ask. And Father, don't let any of us leave here without making some kind of decision, public or private, whether we walk the aisle and talk to the pastor, or whether we stay right there and just talk to you, quiet of our heart. Lord, maybe we already have. And if we haven't, Lord, don't let us leave before talking to you personally, one to one. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'd like to, you can stand. Eric's going to lead us. I'll be here. Steve will be here as well. I'll be happy to talk and visit with you. You come if God tells you to.
No turning back.
bless you, church. Thank you so much. Our worship attendants are going to come forward and give us a chance to give the Lord his tithes and our offerings. And if you filled out a guest card or a prayer request or any of those things, by the way, our prayer warriors did come up with another little wrinkle that they want me to mention to you. Sometimes we have a prayer request, and you know, that piece of paper is only so big. You can only write so much on it. So if you would like to, write on it what you want to write on it, what you can. But then, if you'd like to meet with one of our prayer team members, Steve reminds us every Sunday that they gather right down here in the front. And if you're female, would like a female to pray with you, or male, we have a guy that can pray with you. Maybe you'd like to expound on that a little bit. Maybe you can't get it all on just a couple of lines. So just bring your prayer request over whenever you feel comfortable doing that, and they'll pray with you and be able to get more information to know how to pray. So that's an option open to you as well. Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Lord, it's so good this Christmas season. We thank you, Lord, for this time of the year and what it means to us. And Father, we pray to be filled with your Spirit, to be walking with you, Lord, in every way, God, honoring you, magnifying you, extolling you to be the great God we know you to be. Father, we thank you for what you've done here with us this morning, Bible study hour and worship time, Lord, for the decision that's been made this morning, God. We just give you praise. We bow down before you, Lord. Take this offering that we bring, Lord, it's yours before you ever entrusted it to us to manage. And Father, as we think about Lottie Moon Christmas offering and our desire to see the whole world come to Christ, Lord, these dollars we give in that offering will make a difference in what happens in this world. Help us to participate, to be a part of that, Lord, to listen to what you want us to give, that our gift may not just be one of tip, but it may be one of sacrifice. And God will give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Sandy. I was kind of following the music. Was not prepared for it to end. You know, if a lot of times around Christmas, we find out that people actually get kind of down and depressed about things. And you know, if you'd like to know something about how you can be lifted up in the time when you're humbled, I'd invite you to come down right after we close, talk with me or one of the prayer team members, and let us pray with you about this thing and see how God does that for us. I've only got one announcement, and I want to talk to you about tonight, this evening at 6 o'clock. While all of our musicians are over at another church doing their musical for the first time, we're going to meet here. Those of us who can't carry a tune, we're going to be here, and we're going to watch a short movie on the life of Billy Graham, something that the Billy Graham organization has put together. I'm looking forward to it. I think it's kind of exciting that these guys who have all the video clips and all the information on Billy Graham are going to give us, I think, an inspirational view of his life and how God used him so greatly in his lifetime across the world. So I invite you to come. You also have seen in the bulletin, you who have young children who might not enjoy that movie quite so much, Jessica and the children's ministry is going to show them also a movie that's more age appropriate for them. And if you get a little mixed up about the times, if you'd like to drop them off a little bit early, come in, bring them in at 4:30. They'll watch the kids until we get done with the movie this evening. Or if you want to bring them with you at 6 o'clock, Jessica says doesn't matter. They can take care of them and show them the movie and it should encourage you so that you can come and watch this and understand it and be blessed by it. So I invite you to come back this evening. The movie starts at 6 here in the auditorium. Let's stand and let's close with a word of prayer. Lord God, we come before you, Lord, this morning, realizing each one of us who knows you, Lord, do we know that day when I was humble, when you were humbled before God, just like Mary, that day that we realized that we were hopelessly lost, except that, Lord God, you do something. And you did that something, Lord, through your Son, who you sent to earth humbly himself as a baby, a newborn baby. But his destiny, Lord, was to grow up and to eventually lay down his own life in my place and in our place. And Lord, you promised us, for those of us who would repent and believe in that work of you, that redemptive work, that we can be lifted up, we can be pulled out of our humble mourning and be able to praise you, Lord God, because we're justified in your presence now. We can walk into your presence and you would speak to our hearts and guide us in every situation of life. And Lord, we praise you for this and we thank you for it throughout this season. We ask, Lord, that as we go out this place this morning, that you would guide our hearts and show us, Lord, how you would have us to live as we give ourselves to you. It's in Jesus' great name that we pray. Amen.